A United Nations mission arrives in Nagorno-Karabakh after almost the entire ethnic Armenian population fled since Azerbaijan recaptured the breakaway enclave. Azerbaijan said the UN mission arrived to assess humanitarian needs. It marks the first time in about three decades that the international body has gained access to the region. Armenian separatists, who had controlled the region for 30 years, agreed to disarm, dissolve the government, and reintegrate with Baku. This dealt a heavy blow to a centuries-old dream by Armenians of reuniting what they claim is their ancestral lands. Nearly all of Karabakh's estimated 120,000 residents fled the territory over the following days, sparking a refugee crisis. North Korea slams the UN atomic watchdog for joining a U.S.-led pressure campaign against its nuclear program. Pyongyang's nuclear power industry called the International Atomic Energy Agency, or IAEA, of being a paid trumpeter for Washington. This comes after the IAEA adopted on Friday a resolution calling on the North to curb its nuclear programs. The reclusive nation described the resolution as a result of conspiracy by the U.S. and its allies, adding North Korea's status as a nuclear weapons state is now irreversible. Over in Turkey, Kurdish armed group PKK claims responsibility for Sunday's suicide bombing in Ankara. Both attackers died in what PKK called a sacrificial action against Turkey's interior ministry. This report.
Cell phone video captures the moment assailants detonate a bomb at a security checkpoint near Turkey's Interior Affairs Ministry in the capital city, Ankara. The Interior Ministry's office labeled the blast as a terrorist attack that happened just hours before Parliament was to reconvene.
One of the terrorists who had a suicide bomb contraption blew himself up. The other was shot in the head and neutralized before he found a chance to blow himself up.
The Interior Minister added that he intends to visit two officers injured in the attack, saying neither was in critical condition. Hours after the blast, Turkish President Recep Tayyip Erdogan arrived to address Parliament. He praised the swift action by law enforcement for stopping the attackers.
The action in which two murderers were neutralized is the last stand of terrorism. The scoundrels who targeted the peace and security of the citizens could not achieve their goals. They will never reach them.
A senior Turkish official tells the Reuters news agency the attackers hijacked a vehicle, killing its driver about 260 kilometers southeast of the capital. The bombing was the first in Ankara since 2016. Then, groups such as Islamic State and PKK militants, both labeled as terrorist organizations by the U.S., either claimed or were blamed for attacks on major cities. Arash Arabasadi, VOA News.
At least 13 people killed after a fire broke out in a nightclub in Murcia, Spain. Search efforts continue for those still unaccounted for. The cause of the blaze still unknown. This is the deadliest nightclub fire in Spain in 33 years, following a blaze in 1990 at a nightclub in northeastern Zaragoza that left 43 dead. Murcia's mayor has declared 3 days of mourning for the victims. Another week of turmoil seems to be in the making on Capitol Hill. Hardline Republicans are now looking to oust House Speaker Kevin McCarthy for working with Democrats to avoid a partial government shutdown. Here's the full story.
The bill is passed.
The short-term funding bill that Congress passed Saturday and was signed by President Joe Biden will keep the U.S. government running until at least mid-November. But Biden warned Sunday against a repeat of the chaotic process that preceded the 11th-hour adoption of the stopgap bill.
The brinkmanship has to end, and there shouldn't be another crisis. There's no excuse for another crisis. Consequently, I strongly urge my Republican friends in Congress not to wait. Don't waste time as you did all summer. Pass a year-long budget agreement. Honor the deal we made a few months ago.
But a new showdown might be on the horizon on Capitol Hill. Far-right conservatives aren't happy that House Speaker Kevin McCarthy reached out to Democrats to pass the temporary funding bill. Ousting him is now a top priority for conservative Republican Representative Matt Gaetz.
In January, to get the speakership,
Kevin had to agree to certain guardrails on spending. America's lawmakers take one up or down vote on the funding of the entire government. That is crazy. That is the reason we're $33 trillion in debt. We want to move to single subject spending bills. He made that commitment. He broke it.
McCarthy's response was defiant. He appeared on CBS's Face the Nation.
So be it. Bring it on. Let's get over with it and let's start governing. If he's upset because he tried to push us in a shutdown and I made sure government didn't shut down, then let's have that fight.
Regardless of how that plays out, bipartisan compromises will continue to provide a path forward, said Rachel Snyderman with the Bipartisan Policy Center.
There is bipartisan compromise to support additional funding for Ukraine, to support our troops, and ensure that our border security is well funded. And so I think that we're going to see, you know, action on those particular priorities in the coming weeks.
Ukraine and the rest of the world will be watching closely, pointed out political scientist Oscar Pocasangre.
I think longer term, we do need to focus more on a structural reform to institutions and find ways of having more political parties in Congress that would help us reach more consensus in the legislative body, as opposed to just having a back and forth between these two very polarized parties.
Pocasangre noted as well that more political instability could hurt the United States' credibility as well as its economic standing. Veronica Valderas Iglesias, VOA News, Washington.
The Philippines' golden boy, E.J. Obiena, back home after giving the country its first gold medal in the ongoing 19th Asian Games in Hangzhou, China. Obiena shattered the Asian Games pole vault record by jumping over 5.75 meters, breaking the previous record of 5.7 meters set in the 2018 Asian Games. Obiena now has his sights set on bringing home the gold in next year's Olympics in France.
This one's for me. I don't dedicate it to anything and anyone else. I think this is the last competition of the season. It's been a long, rough year. It's been good, don't get me wrong, but it's not easy. I just want to rest, take care of some responsibilities here in Manila, and probably try to enjoy my life a little bit. No training, no thinking of what I need to do, no routine for the first time in a long time, just wake up and do what I want. Maraming salamat po. So I hope I made everybody happy yesterday, and this win is definitely not just mine, it's for everyone, and I'm sure this is just the first gold that we're going to get for this Asian Games.
Over in the NBA, the arms race in the NBA's Eastern Conference continues. The Boston Celtics are the latest juggernaut in the East to add an all-star point guard this offseason, nabbing former Milwaukee star Jrue Holiday in the deal with Portland. In exchange, the Celtics are sending center Robert Williams III and sixth man Malcolm Brogdon, along with two first-round picks, to the Blazers. Holiday now joins a loaded Boston first five that also includes all-stars Jason Tatum and Jaylen Brown, and fellow new acquisition Kristaps Porzingis. The upgrade comes after East rival Milwaukee traded away Holiday for superstar Damian Lillard, who will team up with two-time MVP Giannis Antetokounmpo. It seems like watching the NFL live is becoming a Sunday thing for pop superstar Taylor Swift. She's back at the MetLife Stadium in New Jersey, not for her sold-out tour, but to cheer on her rumored romance, Kansas City Chiefs tight end Travis Kelce. And she brought along her A-list friends, including Hugh Jackman, Ryan Reynolds, and Blake Lively. We're also entering a new era of Swiftonomics. That's what they call it. Yeah, see, ticket sales for Sunday's Chiefs versus Jets game soared, becoming the second highest selling game of the NFL season, just behind the opener after Swift showed up at Kelce's game last week. Well, two sequels are out in theaters, along with a new sci-fi film. Our resident movie critic Manny the Movie Guy tells us which one is his favorite.
It's the magical meteor that gives the Paw Patrol pups superpowers. In this sequel to the 2021 film, our pups learn how to use powers wisely by looking from within. Based on the popular Nickelodeon TV series, R2 is much better than the original. The animation is superb, and the message packs a punch. Paw Patrol The Mighty Movie is cute, charming, and knows its audience. Simply adorable. And for that, Paw Patrol The Mighty Movie gets 3 out of 4. Paw Patrol is on a roll. Kisses. And for the grown-ups, there's the creator.
It's a peaceful place in the sky.
John David Washington is a hardened ex-Special Forces agent here, looking for redemption. The title may suggest biblical connotations, though this sci-fi flick is about the creator of AI thought to have caused a devastating nuclear explosion that decimated much of downtown LA.
As long as AI is a threat.
Director Gareth Edwards creates a visually stunning film with a timely question. Do we need to fear artificial intelligence itself or its maker? It's a socially conscious flick that's akin to 2009's District 9. And for that, the creator also gets 3 out of 4 futuristic kisses. And for horror fans, there's Saw 10.
You're in very good hands with us.
Saw, the morality play masquerading as torture porn, returns for the 10th time. Yes, there are still some torture scenes, some quite creative, I might add, but this time there's actually a cohesive plotline about Tobin Bell's John Kramer, and that's a good thing.
There's a lot of work that needs to be done.
Set between the events of Saw 1 and 2, this one has Kramer confronting mortality and fraud. Creepy, disturbing, but also constructed well, it's the best Saw film since the first movie, bone crunching and all. And for that, Saw 10 also gets 3 out of 4, game over, kisses. Whether you love animated films, horror, or sci-fi, you'll have a great time at the movies. I'm Manny the Movie Guy for ANC.
Well, heads up, fans of Filipino boy band SB19, they want to celebrate their 5th year in the music industry with you. The group announced on social media they will celebrate their anniversary with a fan meet in Cubao, Quezon City later this month. For more on this story, head on over to news.abs-cbn.com. The famous battle cry, Autobots Rollout, was made famous in the 1980s animated show The Transformers. Fast forward 4 decades later, and humans can now say that iconic Optimus Prime line while riding in their own gigantic transforming robot. Tokyo-based startup Tsubame Industries is set to unveil its high-tech robot called Orcax. It stands nearly 15 feet and has 2 modes, the giant robot mode and the vehicle mode, with a top speed of 10 kilometers per hour. The robot has cockpit monitors, and the pilot can control its arms and hands with joysticks. Tsubame's CEO says while they plan to sell the machines as a toy for robot fans, he also hopes these could be used someday in disaster response or by the space industry. And before you go dreaming of owning one of these, do make sure that you have a ton of spare cash in hand, as each robot costs $2.7 million, or about 153 million pesos.